purpose is how I can raise up ordinary men, turning them to become supernatural beings, financial apostles, making life better, bringing people from the dungeon of sin, bringing them into the faith, planting their feet, and rising them.
What he knows! What he knows!
On deeper matters, they can lay hand on you on headache, but when HIV come, they tell you that it is well with your soul. Am I teaching here? Am I helping you here? So this, they are genuine men of God, but they are word practitioner, and there's nothing bad in being word practitioner, but there is a leap of faith from that level to the next level. And that's the level God wants to take this generation to. And the second kind of prophet are the prophet with the logos and prophetic rhema. In other words, they are word practitioner, and at the same time, they hear the voice of God. Shakabatakata. So paria. How many of you know the dream Joseph had? The dream that is it Pharaoh that had that dream? Pharaoh. And needed somebody to tell him his dream and his interpretation. Now, for God's sake, if you have the Bible, will you use the Bible to tell Pharaoh his dream? How will you tell him his dream? You will open John chapter 14, verse 29. How will you know the dream? Now that's where prophetic revelation comes in. Joseph was able to tell him his dream, and not only his dream, his interpretation. And not only the interpretation, he administrated this prophetic solution through him. That's where you need prophet with prophetic grammars. Prophetic remas. There is a level you get to, all your business goes down. Then you begin to get troubled. This is not ordinary. What is going on? Then you want to hear the voice of God. Then you go to a man of God and say, what is God saying? And he opened John chapter 1 verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And John 14 verse 1, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, also believe in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have not told you that I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. You now hear, say, I understand. But what has this got to do with the problem? This is the reason why members of such men of God go to herbalists to hear the voice of an oracle and return back to the church and sit down and pretend, because they understand that their man of God have a God but cannot hear the voice of his God. And it is an error. Jesus said, I know my sheep and my sheep knows me, and when they hear my voice, they wake up. That the voice of a stranger will they not hear.
John chapter 10. Am I helping you here? Somebody shout a bigger amen.
Amen.
Because we have to go faster. Okay. Now, five killer of prophetic ministry. Five things that kills prophetic ministry. Number one, the spirit of familiarity. Mark chapter 6 verse 4. Luke chapter 4 verse 24. Can you scroll for me? Mark chapter 6 verse 4. Mark. But Jesus said unto them, a prophet is without honor, but in his own country, and among his own kin, and in his own house. Can you scroll Luke 4 24 for me, so that we can balance that together. Still the same scripture. The account of Luke chapter 4 verse 24. He said, and he said, really I say unto you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. That's it. That's
one of the killer of the prophetic ministry. Most often, people don't accept prophets in their town, in their village, in their family. Why? Because of familiarity. No matter how anointed a prophet is, once you look down on the grace, the oil can't work for you. Jesus could not do so many miracles. The Bible says he lay hands on few sick folk, and that was all. He left. And he now said, look, a prophet is without honor. What kills the prophetic ministry is familiarity. And most people that do not benefit from the prophetic ministry are people that are close to the prophet. Why? Because they think they know the prophet. You might know the person of the prophet, but you don't know the God in the prophet. You might know the person of the prophet, but you don't know the God in the prophet. The prophet can come down, play with you. That is the person. The person of the, and that is human nature. And there's a difference between the human nature and the divine nature. Don't think you know a prophet because you know his human nature. His human nature, you can familiarize. But his divine nature, you cannot know. Because at any time, the God of heaven can transform him from anything to anything at every level. That nature is what nature you cannot know. So that you know his age, that you know where he comes from, that you know where he sleeps, that you know how he sleeps, does not mean you know his divine nature. His divine nature is different. Because they keep saying, is it not the son of that carpenter that we used to know? How did it come about, this same miracle? That's why you must be very careful when you are around a prophet, not to take the word of the prophet for granted. Because if you take it for granted, your life will be grinded. And so many people who have been affected around a prophet have been affected by familiarity. And whenever a prophet sees that your body language is a body language of familiarity, he can't prophesy to you, he can't minister to you, he can't get close to you, because he discovered that whatever he does, it will be exercising futility. Number two, killer of the prophetic ministry. Are we there? The spirit of pride. Proverbs 29:23. Proverbs 16:18. A man's pride shall bring him down low, but honor shall uphold the humble in what? In spirit. Whenever a man is proud, he cannot be used by God effectively. There is this tendency that can make a prophet feel very proud, maybe because he feels he's highly used by God. And that's why I'm so much afraid when I see young men that little grace have dropped on them, or prophet that grace of God have dropped on, and they become proud and pompous. When you are operating a prophetic ministry, there must be no pride. And in receiving from a prophet, there must be no pride. You don't look at the age of the prophet to receive from the prophet. You look at the God who speaks through the prophet, who is older than the oldest and older than your great, 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 grand, 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 grand father. So when a small boy stands before you to prophesy, he can be 8 years, he can be 10 years, he can be 21, he can be 35, he can be 45, he can be 40, he can be 50. It does not matter your amount of durability on earth. You don't look at the container that is talking to you. You look at the content inside the container that is called Arugbo Ojo that speaks through the container. So you don't honor the physical container. You honor the content, which is Jehovah, that speaks through that container. So you must be very careful not to be proud to receive from a prophet. That's why I have told people, you don't command a prophet to come to your house. You go to seek God, because oracles of God are not brought down to the house of people. God is in the church, in his holy sanctuary. If you are, no matter your position, whether a president, whether a governor, whether the richest man on earth, when there is a need and the outcry of God for you, you seek God and you don't ask prophets of God to come down to you. It is prophets who don't understand their integrity, their capacity, and their God that run about like political band around politicians. But if you know the mandate of what you carry, you stay where you are. I cannot afford to rubbish the God that sent me. Men can
can rubbish me, but I am here to stand, not to rubbish the oil and the grace of God that is upon me, because I am an ambassador of the Republic of Heaven, and I cannot diminish myself. I cannot bring down the kingdom I represent. Am I talking to somebody here? Somebody shout fire.
Am I helping somebody here? People who are hearing teaching here. Number three, killer of the prophetic ministry is laziness. Proverbs 21:25, slothfulness. Why? Sometimes people receive prophecy and they are lazy. The desire of the slothful killeth him, but his hands refuse to what? Labor. What does that mean? Most people in the prophetic ministry have allowed the prophetic ministry not to be properly balanced, and they become very lousy. For example, if God said you are going to be a billionaire, it should not be an alternative to laziness. So I've seen people lazing around, celebrating prophecy, and not giving the corresponding work. Lazing around, celebrating prophecy, but no corresponding work. God said you are going to marry this year. Does that mean you should fold your hands? You should stay at home? You should wear whatsoever you want to wear? You should not package yourself well? You should abuse all the men you see and think they will marry you? You see why he says, see your head? You see why I say, see you, everybody they propose you, they propose to. Well, you are talking anyhow. Then when you now abuse them, all of them, say, this year is my year. Prophet Joshua Igila says so. It must come to pass. No word of my prophet oil ever drop on the ground. So that is why you are boxing everybody around. God's servant say, I will get a job. You are at home. You don't go out. You don't work. These are the killer. These are the things that kills prophetic ministry. Members are usually very lazy and don't understand the teaching of dignity of labor. Don't understand that you cannot lazy around prophecy and see fulfillment of prophecy. You cannot lazy around prophecy and see fulfillment of prophecy. God said you are going to have twins. Fine. And you have not touched your wife since 3 months after God said so. I salute you very, very well. I salute you. You have become village lazy headmaster. God said it that you are going to have twins. It is true. But you are running from your wife since that prophecy came. Then when you wake up in the morning, you say, my wife, our twins is coming. Shout fire. And your wife will say, fire. Say fire, yeah, yeah, yeah. Your wife say, fire, yeah, 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 yeah. You say, bye-bye. You go to work again. And you are doing that for 3 months. And you are saying, God, I've not answered your prayer. You know the problem. You are the killer of that prophecy. Number four. Delayed expectation is one of the killer of prophetic ministry. Proverbs chapter 13 verse 12. Hope that is deferred maketh the heart to be sick. But when desire cometh, it is like a tree of life. What does that mean? Sometimes when people are expecting their prophecy to manifest and it does not manifest, their heart becomes sick. And so as a result of that, it kills prophecy for those who are impatient. Delayed expectation. And at this level, you must understand that every vision is for an appointed time. Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 2. And the Lord answered me and said, write a vision and make it plain upon the tables, and that he may run that readeth it. Verse 3. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak. And not lie, though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come to pass. It will not what? Tarry. So you must understand, you must wait for every vision. Every vision has an appointed time. Every vision, every prophecy is like a time bomb. And when the time comes for it to explode, nobody can curtail it. It will explode. Don't detonate your prophecy when it is not time for explosion, because it will bring about premature manifestation and lead to premature death. Prophecy have the potency and have the time to manifest. Don't fast forward.
forward the hand of God, he will come to you at the appointed time. I carried one prophecy for about 19 years, and I thought it was going to come to pass the very year God spoke. It came to pass after 19 years. God have a time for everything. He will come to you and at his appointed time. Don't force his hand. And hear this. It doesn't matter whether you have suffered for 17 years. One day pleasure with God can eradicate 17 years of struggle. One day pleasure with God can make you... I know what I'm talking about. I have seen suffering and I've entered into blessing. And I can tell you that one day blessing with God can make you forget 20 years of lifetime torment. You are not getting what I'm saying. So it does not matter how long. It does not matter how long. The Bible says, they that wait upon the Lord. Ah, prophet, I don't understand. When will I marry? The Bible says, wait. They that wait upon the Lord, they shall renew their strength. Can I hear you shout fire 3 times? Another killer of the prophetic ministry is unbelief. John chapter 12 verse 48, the spirit of unbelief. When you don't believe your prophet, you cannot prosper. When you don't believe God, you cannot be established. 2 Chronicles 20:20, believe the Lord God, that shall be established. Believe his prophet, that shall prosper. John chapter 12 verse 48. So you must understand how to believe. He that rejected me and received me not my words, had one that judged him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. So when you don't believe God, believe your prophetic word, you kill the prophetic ministry over your life. Now, let me just add and give you 9 ways to hear from God. 9 ways to hear from God. Number one, you hear from God through what I call night vision. Job chapter 33, verse 14 to 17. For God speaketh once, yea, twice, yet men perceive it not. In dream, in the vision of the night, when the deep sleep falleth upon men, he slumbering upon the bed, then he openeth the ears of men and sealeth their instruction, that he may withdraw man from his purpose and he pride from man. You see, now that's what we call night vision. Night vision. In night vision, this is the deep part of the night. The deep part of the night. And the night vision sometimes is what you call dreams, but the Bible calls it the night vision. When you go to sleep, when the whole place is dark, he selects you with instruction. He withdraws you from pride. He gives you instruction. He shows you through vision. He shows you through vision. And each time we talk about vision, we talk about pictures that are given to you by God. Now listen to me. There are 2 types of vision, and there's what we call open vision. No, 3 types of vision. There's what we call open vision. Open vision is when your eyes are open, but you are seeing things. Open vision. Your eyes are open. The way you are looking at me, you are watching me, you are watching the television, is called open vision. So you can walk with God that your eyes open like this, and your eyes is not closed, but you are watching cinema. You are seeing things that is happening. It is being dramatized just the way it should be. It is called open vision. That's what we call God-given vision. That God-given vision is the one I'm talking about, that you sleep and God shows you. And that's what we call imagination vision. These are kind of things that happen as a result of your activities throughout the day. Now hear this, there is a storage system in your spirit being, that all the activities you do throughout the day is being stored somewhere. That sometime when you are not too spiritually loaded, demons will upload your day-to-day activities for you. Or naturally, your system will upload your day-to-day activities. How many of you have seen yourself? What you did in the daytime, you saw yourself in the dream doing the same thing.
These are things as a result of the way you are play and play. Your spirit has been loaded with natural things that spiritual things cannot be upgraded and uploaded in your system. So there is a way your system can replay back those things that you have done during the day.
And so those kind of visions should not be taken serious. They are vision born out of activities. You can love a man so much in the physical realm and you see him in the dream. Then you see your two of you are matching. You and I will live as one. You and I. You and I. Hey, you and I will live as one.
And it's because you love the man.
Then those kind of dreams will be mesmerizing you. Then when they are about to join you and they say, kiss the bride, the man will not disappear.
Why?
It's to show you that your imagination is playing with you.
There is a way you can be very hungry when you are fasting. Then you saw a big pole of pounded yam in the presence of Prewinko and a day Kaikon.
Then, am I communicating? Am I communicating?
You saw it. You are very hungry. You know there's a way you can be doing dry fasting and you are seeing yourself swallowing. Then you not try to sleep. They will not bring the food for you. Then you see yourself eat the food in the dream. It's as a result of imagination. It might not even be that it's evil caterers that give you the food. It's just your imagination. You are very hungry. It was uploaded to your system and it was replayed back to you. Am I helping you? There is a way you can hate somebody and you overhate the person and you start seeing the person chasing you in the dream. Not because the person is a winch, but because it has entered your system. So such kind of vision, you don't call it vision, they're imaginations. So you must know when it is God-given. When is it God-given? When I am not thinking about it, I'm not imagining it, it never comes to my heart, but it flows in. So God brought it in. Am I helping you now? Am I helping you now? You have never dreamt evil about somebody, but you start dreaming evil about the person because you hate the person. As a result of your hatred, you start seeing the person chasing you with cutlass. It is imagination.
Okay. Number two, 9 ways to hear from God. Number two, through trance. Trance is a detachment from one's surrounding. A half conscious state. Numbers 24, verse 4. Look at it. He said, he has said, which heard the words of God, which saw the vision of the Almighty, falling into trance, but having his eyes open. When you fall into trance, sometimes your eyes will just be open. And you go in and you come back. And hear this, when we talk about trance, you can receive an information that can be as long as 1 hour under a few seconds.
In trance, you see, all this one I'm talking about are pictures. You are not hearing voice, but you are seeing pictures. And the pictures is dramatizing the message. Are you getting it now? Because some of you, when you are talking about hearing from God, you think it's until when God speaks, sometimes he brings pictures. You are just looking at that and you fell into it, and before you know, you come back. And as you come back, you are aware of everything that happened. At that time, that issue. Issue of trance are issue of emergency. God did not want to wait for you to go to the bed. He has to tell you quickly so that you can act on it quickly. So he borrows your subconsciousness. At that time, an angel will just come shut your reasoning of the flesh and switch you to the spirit and bring you back. Are you getting this? You need to understand this very well. An angel will come, shut you down, and on you to the spirit. Send the data to your system, bring you back, then on you back,
then you are alive. Before you know, say, something does happen. You remember everything. That's trance. You need to understand this. That's why, as prophet, as prophetic generation, we don't play about. Because at any time, message of emergency can come to our data. Pulse. We don't play around. We don't talk anyhow. We can just be gisting like this and we hear some noise. Bam! We capture, download, process, bring them out, read them, and go into action. Number three. How do you hear from God? By the written word of God. Psalm 138 verse 2. I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name for the loving kindness and for thy truth. For thou hast magnified thy word above thy name. Thou hast exalted thy word above thy name. So you can receive, you can hear from God through his word. Sometimes you can even be in a dream and God refer you to a scripture. John chapter 14 verse 18. You wake up and you go to read the scripture and you get direct message from the word of God. That's another way to hear from God. But this is the problem of the word practitioner prophet. They believe that this is the only way to hear from God. I beg to disagree with you. Although this is the number one way to hear from God. But this is not the only way to hear from God. This is the number one way to hear from God. But this is not the holy way to hear from God. Number four. You hear from God in what I call words of knowledge. Now let me explain to you what words of knowledge is. Some people don't understand words of knowledge. And they have sometimes describe it as prophecy. Words of knowledge is having a knowledge about a thing that you don't know as an impartation. I explain. If I don't know this brother before, I don't know him before. I don't know his name. I don't know where he's born. I don't know anything. Words of knowledge is not hearing a voice. It is having a complete comprehensive knowledge about a thing. It comes to you as a knowing. I don't know where you're getting me. It comes to you as a knowing, as a knowledge. What is democracy? Is government by the people, for the people, and whatever you define it. Now hear this. That's a knowledge, isn't it? That's a knowledge, isn't it? That's how it is. Words of knowledge comes as a knowledge, a knowing. You are just moving and you look at somebody and you just know the person as if you know him before. It comes as a knowledge. It doesn't come as a voice. It comes as a knowledge. And what I mean as a knowledge, a knowing. That's how words of knowledge operates. It comes as a knowing. So God does speak to you about something. And when he wants to say it to you, he does not speak. He baptizes you with the information. You just look at the person, you just know. Somebody is just talking to you, you just know he's lying. Not that you heard a voice, but you know. You are operating in words of knowledge. Words of knowledge is what? In knowing. In other words, it's words that empower your data system with information. You just know. You just know. Another way God speaks to us, he speaks to us through words of wisdom. As I am teaching now, I am saying certain tips, statements that I might not know, but God is directing my language to send them to you. And as it enters your ear, you know this is the voice of God for me. That's voice of wisdom.